So I want to welcome everyone to the second annual Faculty Author Spotlight. Thank you all so much for joining us today. My name is Melissa Chomintra. I'm the Scholarly Engagement Librarian for the Social Sciences and Geospatial Data at Howard Tilton Memorial Library. And I'm super excited to moderate our first of three live chats of this virtual series. We will have another tomorrow and Wednesday with two other groups of faculty authors that will share their work with us. And today we've got a really great bunch of faculty authors. I'm sure you have been enjoying our candid chat so far. It's been really nice to sort of just chat off the cuff with all of you and sort of shake some of the semester stress away. So today we have with us Ronna Berger, professor of philosophy, who will be sharing their book with us, Nature Law and the Sacred Essays in Honor. Actually, this is really special because this was written in honor of Ronna. So that's something that I haven't heard of before. So I'm excited to hear more about how this happens. I know it's something that's kind of specific to philosophy from what I understand. We also have Dr. Dennis Kehoe, professor of classical studies. They'll be sharing with us their book titled Roman Law and Economics, Volume 1, Institutions and Organization. We also have Dr. Kris, professor of history, with their work, Potosi, if I'm saying that correctly, The Silver City That Changed the World. Dr. Nancy Maveety, professor of political science, with Glass and Gavel, the US Supreme Court and Alcohol, which I'm also excited to hear more about. Dr. Adam McKeown, professor of medieval and early modern studies, with their work Fortifications and Its Discontents from Shakespeare to Milton, Troubled in the Walled City. And lastly, Dr. Esra Oskin, professor of communication, with their work Mainstreaming of the Headscarf, Islamic Politics and Women in the Turkish Media. So as I mentioned, we have a few prearranged questions to ask all the panelists, and then we'll take questions from attendees if we've got time at the end. So I'm gonna jump right in with the first question, and y'all can unmute yourselves and answer as you'd like. If you all want to answer the question, that is absolutely fine. If you don't want to share, that is also okay. There are three pre-range questions, and the first is, how and why did you choose your book topic?
Who's gonna start?
Yeah, I don't want to call on anybody. I don't want to be that kind of person.
My class.
Okay, well,
I know, right?
I'll start with this one because my book is probably the most unconventional in the sense that it's the most popular oriented, probably, of our scholarly works, because it's a history of both alcohol and alcohol law, specifically with respect to the US Supreme Court and the Constitution, but it's also a history of alcohol in American political culture and particularly cocktail culture. So it's a fusion of two of my interests, frankly. I'm a scholar of the US Supreme Court and of constitutional law and of judicial decision making. And I'm also interested in social policy and law. But I'm also a cocktail enthusiast and an amateur historian of alcohol in the United States. And so this book was an effort to put together two interests of mine and also to try to find somewhat of a more popular frame for talking about the history of the Supreme Court to make it more accessible to a broader audience.
I guess I can also answer. My book sort of chose me because this is a big two-volume collection of essays that involves scholars from law, economics, and ancient history writing about Roman law and economics. And I was originally a contributor, and I know the person who came up with the idea fairly well, but it soon became pretty obvious that he would need a great deal of editorial help, especially adapting the people who were not scholars of the ancient world to talking about the ancient world. So that's how I got involved with mine.
I'll go ahead and answer the question myself. My book, Fortification and Its Discontents from Shakespeare to Milton, it was the classic case of unanswered questions in the first book. I did not set out in life to be one of the only people who does military cultures and literature in the early modern world. I kind of fell into that, as I think a lot of young scholars do. It was something I could do. I mean, my dissertation was on aesthetics. You know, I deal with pictures and poetry and the illusion of images in writing. And I was recalled and deployed, and suddenly it seemed a no-brainer to write about soldiers and poets. In the process of doing that research, I kept running into this statement that was made. The scholars, we get used to hearing these commonplaces that need to be questioned, talking about, well, of course, the new age of warfare, because the city walls were now torn down and armies, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I love to do archival research and I love to do in situ research. I go out there and I find the old rocks. I write better surrounded by the old buildings. So there I am in Quebec. I'm in the west coast of Africa. I'm looking at buildings that, when they were tearing down walls, it seemed to me they're actually building new ones. So I wanted to know what this was about. And I sort of discovered that changes to military cultures and militarization as a concept were forcing radical and widespread rebuilding of the of the European environment during the periods when the walls were supposed to be coming down. So I decided to focus on that.
I can chime in too. My book is about Turkey and Turkish media. I'm interested in the country. I grew up there, born and grew up there. And I was interested in understanding the recent history and politics since 2002. And especially in 2002, the current president came to power. And since then, the country took an authoritarian direction. And the book is an effort to understand how this happened, why this happened, and what is women's role in it. So it was kind of an effort to understand what happened, how did this happen, because this authoritarian turn wasn't expected at the time. Nobody could see what was coming. So that was an effort to understand what changed after 2002.
Yeah, I can just say that it's really great to be here, and I appreciate you guys putting this together. It's really, really wonderful. And I can see with our panel, we have, as a historian, pretty great coverage of time periods going from ancient to the present. And I sort of fall in the middle along with Adam. I guess it's the middle. I work on the 16th and 17th centuries. And I sort of fell into this book project after realizing that I just was really ignorant of the big scope of my topic. And I was working on something very pointed and definitive about a great fraud, a gigantic fraud that occurred in the middle of the 17th century. But I felt like I needed to have a sense of the big scope of time. And so the place I studied, Potosí, Bolivia, was the most important silver producing region of the world for several hundred years. And it altered global economics and as a consequence, many other things, but starting with economics. I wanted to globalize Latin America. I guess that was my initial desire, to take a part of the world that's often seen as peripheral and secondary and often victimized by other places and try to put it at the center. And so I did have an agenda and that was to kind of promote this place and say, globalization is nothing new. And in fact, Latin America was front and center. So that pushed me along.
Thank you.
As Melissa was saying, it's great to have your book that you didn't have to do all the work to write. I've written books, but this is very nice. It's not just philosophy, Melissa, but there's it's really, I think, probably from German academic world, the Festschrift, like a celebratory writing. And it's usually a collection of volumes for a mentor or a scholar. Typically you're 65 or 70 or 75 years old, somewhere in that range. And it's meant to show the influence of that person's work by students and other scholars. So as I think in one of those videos, I said, I've actually been at Tulane for 40 years. And my first PhD student right at the beginning, Evan Theospeliotis, put this thing together. And there are other graduate students from different cohorts over the years and friends and colleagues. Richard Velkley, you know, he's got a really beautiful essay on Lessing in here. And I think that the hard part was when you do a volume like this, a collection, you're just doing it by the people who studied or were influenced, but you don't know for sure if it'll come together as a whole. And I think we were all really excited to see how much this did. And the title sort of was what pulled it together, those themes, that conflict or the tension between nature and convention. And then the way that relation is connected and turned with the sacred. And that reflected my work, especially in ancient Greek philosophy and the Bible, an uneasy relation of the two roots of our whole Western tradition. So it was exciting to get this, and I think it's a way beyond what I could have done myself. I mean, the essays go all the way to Kierkegaard and Descartes and Boccaccio and Dante and Maimonides, you know, way beyond my own narrow sphere. So but you see the resonance of your ideas and themes over history. So it's really kind of very satisfying.
I can imagine it just seems so special and rewarding, you know, and obviously very well deserved. So
I don't know about that, but
thank you all for sharing your answers to our first question. I'm gonna ask the second, which is, what was the most difficult and or most rewarding part of writing this or editing this publication in terms of like the process or, your process?
Well, I guess for me, the most rewarding thing was to be able to bring a project that I didn't really start, but I was part of at the beginning through many twists and turns to a final. And I think from what other people have said, a very successful conclusion. And it was partly because it involved scholars, some of whom are quite famous from law and economics in my humble field. So, you know, it was a challenge to make a work that actually had some kind of unity to it in terms of its intellectual reach. And it was a lot of work. So the most satisfying thing, I guess, was when I got the volumes on my front porch in June, showing that it was actually done.
I'll go next. I'll just say that this may seem like a strange answer, but the answer is it hasn't happened yet. For those of you who are listening or attending the panel or are not in the business, you'd be surprised to learn that we don't have millions of people buying these books. You know, so a lot of times the influence of what you do doesn't manifest for a decade. And like when my first one came out, it was not, I don't think it was very well received at all. The Renaissance Quarterly made fun of me. Within 10 years though, two books just like it came out. You know what I mean? Because you're breaking new ground. You're talking about something no one's talked about before, and other scholars follow you. And now I look back on it and say, that was satisfying. Like right now, nobody except me is talking about fortifications and literature in the 17th and 16th centuries. I'm it. And at some point, someone will ask the same questions, and you know, they'll look at my book and say, you know, he's got some good ideas, but not great ideas. I think I've got great ideas. I'm going to build on those. And then all of a sudden you see like, wow, you're actually enlarging knowledge. So I look forward to the satisfaction, but I suspect it'll be 5-10 years from now.
Thanks for sharing that. I think it's a good reminder to all scholars and, you know, budding scholars, you know, to pursue those passions, and that you might not see, you know, these accolades come through immediately. And it's not always about like the short game, right? But what you actually contribute overall. So I think that's a great reminder.
Oh, let's see. I wanted to add something. I've gone kicking and screaming into each new technological development, but it really is so interesting to me because my, you know, experience for so many decades, what Adam just described, but now with these sites that I never thought I would do, but academia.edu and these videos we do that get, you know, I mean, it's interesting. I'm finding out people in, you know, Turkey and all over the world are reading your work. You can find out where they are. I don't know. It's interesting to me. It's a very different world in the last, and especially with our, you know, current virtual distance learning and all that. I think my work has gotten more widespread quickly than ever before, because of all these new developments that I resisted.
Yeah, I could add to that. I just last summer my book came out just before I was traveling, when it was still possible to travel. I traveled to Bolivia. And I took a bag with, you know, as much weight as you could put in it, a disposable bag with books, just copies of this Potosí book, because I was going to a conference in Potosí, and I wanted to give copies to the people in the archives and everybody there, even though most of them were like, let us know when it comes out in Spanish. This is nice, but we can't read it. But I actually carried these books across a swollen river and, you know, had this experience of, you know, I'm actually like in the colonial period, hauling books to the periphery to distribute them. So I guess the most rewarding thing for me was that experience of getting the books to the place that the book's about. And then if everything else is fine, I don't care if the reviews are positive or negative. Well, I do care, but
did you take pictures of yourself at the swollen river? Because I love this idea of like, I've got to get these books to the archive, man.
I have pictures of my very wet lower half, yeah, holding a suitcase on my shoulders.
Too bad it's too late for the jacket photo.
Yeah. I think that's extraordinary. I'm not sure if everybody gets that experience, you know. I mean,
I don't recommend it.
Right, like swollen river aside, but being able to bring, you know, this piece of work to the actual place that it's about, I think that's, you know, potentially once in a lifetime. I don't know. Hopefully not, but you know, very rewarding. I'm assuming. I have no idea.
Well, I was at a conference one time and it rained. So I guess that would be fine.
It's pretty much the same thing.
Yeah.
I mean.
I want to know, did you keep a journal? Like at night, like tonight, the swollen river stopped us from the passage, but fortunately my...
The great book delivery. I'll write that story for the New Yorker.
Were you wearing a pith helmet at the time?
Sounds like a Geary and the Wrath of God.
It was closer to that.
Yeah.
No, but I will say the review process, very much as Adam said, it's a slow thing. And so you kind of, you're tempted to keep checking and say, has somebody published a review yet? And finally, when they come out, they usually, you know, they're like, oh, they got it. Or no, they just didn't get it. They didn't see what I was trying to do. I had a review like that recently where it was clear the author of the review just either missed my point entirely or was writing about a different book. I couldn't tell. And then another review came out just a little bit later, and it was just like, oh man, that's exactly what I had in mind. I'm glad it worked. Why is it that it didn't work with this person? You never know.
This is true. Yeah.
Everyone has their own version of your book.
You know, to speak about the front end of the production, right? We're talking about the reception and things like that. To think about, you know, what are both the challenges and the rewarding things in the production of a book. I would say in the case of this book, I had a couple of, you know, challenging but ultimately rewarding experiences. One is just the experience that I'm sure, you know, Kris can identify with, any historian can identify with, and that is searching through an archive and finding, the gem, the evidence that you needed to make some connection. In my instance, it was between a particular Chief Justice and a particular favorite cocktail, since that's one of the motifs of my book. And so among the things I did was wade into judicial papers, which, as many of you know who work with archives, are often not very well organized. And so you're just sifting through all kinds of things and getting an impression of a life. That was really fun for me. I don't typically do that kind of work because I'm a political scientist, but it was immensely fun. And I would love to do more of it. And then I suppose the other, this is, may seem pretty prosaic and mundane, but some of the most rewarding episodes for me were securing the permissions for images that I wanted to use. Man, I mean, you wouldn't believe some of the hurdles one has to surmount. And everybody, I believe in copyright law, sure. But you know, there are sometimes obstacles that you don't know will be there, both financial and otherwise. And for some books, images are really critical to capture an epoch or to get a sense of a person. And when I secured a particular image that I wanted, having to go through a deceased artist's family, well, I was like, yeah. So that was kind of a run of the mill production level reward, but I think it made the book stronger.
Wow.
I wanted to add something.
Can I ask what the favorite cocktail was?
Oh.
I'd have to ask.
I don't want to get too deep in the weeds. Well, this was Chief Justice Harlan Fiske Stone, who was known to be a great wine lover, and who served essentially during World War II. He had a pretty short tenure of office. But I knew that was a period in which rum was really, really popular as a beverage, again, was really, really popular in the United States, partly because of the legacy of prohibition when domestic production had been shut down. And so consumers in the United States had turned to the Caribbean. And so this had amped up a real taste for rum. But everything we knew about Stone was that he disdained cocktails. But I found a hand-typed recipe that he had saved for a rum-based cocktail. And so it just validated for me everything about his era and things that we didn't necessarily know about this former professor, who was supposedly a big wine and cheese fan, but also partook of the things that were popular in the time.
Two things. One, I'm going to send Nancy, if you don't know, there's a website of cocktails named after famous scholars. I'll send you the link later. It's great. But I also, on the image issue and getting permission, the press kind of covered up my image with the title, but this image I had picked for another project, which I heard in a classics lecture. It's Dura Europas. And there's it's such a fantastic time with the Greek and biblical, Hebrew and Greek. So this is the Temple of Solomon with Greek columns and everything. It was an amazing, for me to discover the image was so great. It really was about Athens and Jerusalem, which is my world. And then it was a struggle to get permission to use it. But at the end, it turned out it wasn't for my book. It was someone else, it was taken over for my editor here.
this whole topic, maybe it'll spawn questions, but you know, with Ronna's earlier comment about technology, copyright law isn't what it used to be either, right? So I mean, in the case of if someone who owns the photograph is still alive, but certainly what, you know, Kris and I work with, there's no one left alive. But so sometimes if an archive owns that image, if it's actually a digital, a high quality digital image that is that someone else owns, you're allowed to use theirs without permission. That's changed. I mean, that's a new thing. And I don't even know how I feel about that. I mean, that's not necessarily what we're talking about today, but just sort of the way the writing and the scholarly writing has changed. We can now use images without permissions. And I feel like some part of the book is lost if I don't get to say, you know, I want to express my gratitude to the National Archives in Dublin as if I've been there and they know me, you know what I mean? But now I don't get to do that because I can just take it from someone else who has it.
You can still give a shout out to the National Archives of Dublin. They'll always appreciate that, I'm sure.
Yeah, I advise my graduate students to plan on another year getting their permissions together.
Wow. And images.
It's almost an extra book. Even though things, as Adam says, they've gotten a lot easier, it just takes a lot longer than you imagine, even with email and PDFs and documents that you can sign without sending them, you know, through the regular mail. It's still really tough. I had this cover image in mind from the very beginning, because it encapsulates the story of the book. It's the mountain, it's the Inca, and the pillars of Hercules that stand for the Habsburg World Empire. And the silver in the middle is actually visible on the original image. And there are llamas and people on the mountain. But this image belongs to an Irish baron. And I had to write to him personally. And, you know, I didn't know exactly how to address him. I'm like, Your Grace, Your Mercy, was it your most humble servant is requesting this use of this image. But he said, just call me Sean. And so Sean allowed me to use this message or this image. He sent me a handwritten permission and said, no, I'm just glad it's going to be on the book. That's great. But it's that reminder that it is a collaborative project, even though, you know, we take credit. My name is on there as the author. There are a lot of other people that are involved in the production team. And in this case, I was even really surprised when it arrived because they put kind of a silver lining into the book. I never asked for anything, but they kind of did a really nice job with the production. And I was like, man, this is the best looking book I've ever produced. I'm really amazed. So when a press feels like they want to push your stuff, it can be kind of nice.
Okay. I'm going to move on to our last question, and then we'll have some time for folks to ask questions. Any of the attendees can ask questions, or y'all can ask questions of each other. And then for the attendees, when you do want to ask a question, I think you have the ability to raise your hand and then we can unmute you if you want to vocalize your question, or you can also use the Q&A. So our last question, did anything you learn while researching the topic surprise you? Were there any big surprises or things that that you discovered that you didn't expect that you'd wanna share?
Well, I had a big surprise. One of the papers in the thing I was editing was written by two economists, and to make their discussion of the ancient world, say, more historically accurate, I wound up co-authoring an article with them, or a paper with them. And so I thought it was kind of cool that I worked with two economists whom I never even met, and we have a co-authored paper. So that's being interdisciplinary for you.
Yeah. I discovered Ireland. Well, the others, I'm inviting questions on this topic. A lot of times probably each of us has an area that's closely related to what we study that we have avoided, like the mines of Moria, if you follow the Tolkien, like there's this dark place that, you know, I just don't want to deal with it because it's too much work that I don't know about. And for me, doing British studies, I mean, doing a lot with Elizabethan and Jacobean England, and, you know, and also revolutionary England, I didn't deal with Ireland because I grew up with Irish nationalism as being such a dominating that whole world. And in this book, I couldn't avoid it anymore. I had to like start dealing with Ireland. And so I did, and discovered that in the 21st century, a lot of that, the baggage of that sort of fictional Irish nationalism and that weird Celtic racial identification is now finally giving way to something better and new. And sort of discovering that whole world of scholarship that I could get into, and this thing that I'd been avoiding dealing with, I just dealt with. And it was so much fun and exciting, and I can't wait to do more.
I can share a surprising point throughout my writing. So in my book, I'm analyzing the columns of women journalists who support Erdogan, the guy who came to power in 2002 in Turkey. So these are women who write in newspapers that support him. But these women also, before they Erdogan came to power, they were seen as people who would kind of contribute to the improvement of democracy in the country. So when I started working on their columns, I thought, okay, these journalists, probably they see politics differently from me. And probably they, when I started writing, you know, I regularly observed concentration of power in the hands of Erdogan. And I thought I was seeing something, like I was seeing an increasing authoritarianism and concentration of power, but I thought they saw something different. So they didn't see what I was observing. But when I started reading their columns one by one, I realized that, oh wow, no, they observe the same things. You know, they observe more concentration of power, they observe increasing authoritarianism, they observe things are going wrong, but they still support him. And they will continue to support him, and they continue to support him to this day. So this was a very surprising point for me. So that was something to think more about.
I had a surprise in reading this book and receiving it. I knew that all of the modern thinkers would be new material for me and very interesting, but new. But Adam said before, there's something close to your work that you have avoided for years, and it's a big gap. For me, that was the thinker Xenophon, the writer Xenophon, who wrote Socratic dialogues, but is much less studied than Plato. And it's really shameful that I've never really studied Xenophon. So there's a chapter in this book on Xenophon, and he's so presciently modern in a really interesting way, and it was just a fascinating study. So I got excited about it, and I'm teaching it this semester. So that was an influential surprise.
Well, I guess among the surprises that I encountered in doing this book, which I would describe as a fun book, I mean, I did it for fun, was first of all, just how much constitutional law throughout the history of the court's interpretation of the Constitution and application to policy questions, to legal questions, how much of that has concerned alcohol in some way, and how alcohol and its regulation or questions about the right to use it or using it in certain circumstances or commerce involving alcohol, how much of every step developmentally of US constitutional law has some alcohol related connection to it. And I suspected this at the outset, that's why I wanted to write the book, but the findings were even more, jarring, I suppose, that this really is a motif that makes sense for understanding US political culture and constitutional culture.
Yeah, I think I could add that every time you sit down to start a project, whether it's an article or a book, not that we do books all the time, they take a long time, but it's a process of discovery. I mean, you set out thinking it's going to look kind of like this, and I suspect it's going to shape up like so, and I have a pretty good working hypothesis I'm fairly confident in. And then as you're working it through, it changes directions, or at least in my experience, it's a process of, oh, okay, I didn't know about that, and now I need to fill this in, or I see a gaping hole, you know, as Adam and Ronna have already said, I see something that I missed, and I guess I have to go into that now. I have to figure that out. So in a strange way, writing a book is more of a process of discovery for the scholar. And then when you're done with it, at a certain level, you're kind of like, okay, now I'm on to something else. I've spent 5-10 years working on that. Now I think I've got it figured out to my satisfaction, maybe not to anyone else's, and I'm going to do something else now. But that's satisfying, even if, you know, our readerships are not huge. That's sort of the nature of the beast. And I really do appreciate Tulane's support. I have to say, it's been a really supportive place to be a scholar. And, you know, all the way along with, you know, financial support, it's always a struggle. I mean, everybody has to piece things together, but it's been a really good place to do scholarship.
What you say is good advice for PhD students too. Right, it's not gonna all be firmly fixed in the proposal. You can remain open to new discoveries, if you will.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm gonna cheat. I know that I said that was my last question for you all, but Kris made me think to ask when you were chatting just now about, you know, you're already on to the next thing or thinking about the next thing. Would you all mind sharing like what that next thing is for you potentially, if you have something in the works or that maybe it's just a little seedling in this moment, if you wanted to share?
This is a really significant question for me because I've been very slow, 10, 15, 20 years on Plato, another 20 years on Aristotle. I move really hesitantly. And I've been teaching these courses at Tulane on Bible and philosophy. And in the academic world, as we all know, you stay in your own lane, right? You develop scholarly skills and a background and training and connections. And it's not so easy to move out of that. So I myself, now it's a number of years, probably another 10 years, moving toward wanting to write on the Bible, which I've been teaching happily, but it's different to write on something than to teach it. So yeah, that's a really interesting experience. I think some people are more bold and innovative, but just how academia can keep you, you know, railed. It's not so easy to break out of these alleys and move in new directions. So teaching can help with that too, because most of us teach more broadly than our scholarly work. Yeah. Anyway, that's what I want to do next.
I have just completed another project after the book. It was a journal project, and I had an article in it about the alimony debates that took place in Turkey in the last year. And my next project, I think, is to rest a bit and gather energy, experience life in other dimensions of life, and then go back to writing. But my next project is to gather my energy and rest.
Well, I have a long-term project on land and many different aspects in the Roman world. But I also, you know, I think a lot of us, we get asked to write things. And so they always seem to come up first. And so right now I'm supposed to be finishing up something on poverty in the ancient world, for a more general collection on poverty, economic aspects of poverty. And then I have another essay that is sort of related to the land project, but for I was just at a conference for the other one just before this. So there's always seems like there's a lot of things to do.
I'd like to return to something that Ronna mentioned, and that's the nexus with teaching. One thing that was generated by my work on this book was a special topics course I did a few iterations of, and my colleagues convinced me to entitle it Booze, Drugs, and the Courts, so it would sound more enticing, and I guess it was. But what it asked me to think about were some of the parallels in both regulation and rights debates over the saga of alcohol in American law and current debates over both the legalization of cannabis and also the saga of narcotic drugs and other drug substances in the United States. And of course, this recent election cycle, we had some very interesting state referenda on these questions. And you know, in my course, I tried to put it all together into some sort of organized theme, but I learned a lot. And I learned that there are lots of directions that this work about controlled substances and intoxicants and the law could go. And of course, the obvious debate to investigate is the saga of marijuana in the United States. And of course, the current seeming, move towards greater and greater openness with respect to both medical and recreational cannabis, as it's preferred to be termed. So that represents, a huge opportunity and ability to co-author and collaborate with people who are public opinion scholars and things like that. So I'm very excited about lots of different directions. And I continue to research historic cocktails, of course, and think about what should be our totemic cocktail for the Trump era.
For me right now, it's a fun question, a frustrating one. In some ways, for British studies, especially because of the imperial shadow is withdrawing, it's wide open again. It's very exciting. It's an exciting time to be alive in British studies. I mean, it really is. As I said, Ireland is you can actually do Irish studies without having to deal with Irish 19th and 20th century Irish nationalism. You can look at things like the Ulster plantation and without having to look at it as a 20th century problem, as early 17th century problem that is wound up in 20th century politics. England itself is sort of looking at its own existence and questioning paradigms like, it's isolation. I mean, I've seen wonderful scholarship coming out of England saying like England wasn't isolated. I mean, back then, and Dennis can probably talk to this more, oceans connected, land separated, right? Getting from ancient what is now China to what is now Europe was really, really hard to do across land, but water connected things. I've seen British scholars even questioning like, what did the Anglo-Saxons look like? Like, what did people look like in England back in the first century AD? And the answer is they didn't necessarily have like red haired braids. I mean, they we don't really know. I mean, connections between Britain and in Phoenician cultures, wide open. But for the same reason, it's wide open here too. So what I would love to do is talk more about the idea of England and its past, freed from the legacy of empire and, in some ways freed from the legacy of 20th century Marxist scholarship, which merely recast the same paradigms of imperial thinking, but in a sort of an adverse way, is wide open. But what I would really like to do is go and look at this continent, especially looking at looking at people like Red Cloud and others as important American figures and repositioning them in the dialogue. I just got out of you know, Army War College this year, and I asked the question, you know, point blank to the folks, which we could do, like, why are we looking at General Lee again? Why are we looking at Red Cloud? You know, I mean, why are we talking about the tactics of General Jackson? Why are we talking about Red Cloud? You know, those are questions about that are vaguely early modern that I would love to see us do, and like reposition, really look at this continent as a whole bunch of things and a whole bunch of people that also that contributed to it in ways that we haven't even started to discuss.
Does anybody else want to add anything before I open it up to questions? It looks like we already have a couple in the Q&A. So a reminder, pop your questions into the Q&A, which is different from the chat. We are using the Zoom webinar platform, so it's a little bit different. You should see a Q&A button at the bottom of your Zoom screen. So pop those in there, and I'm happy to read those out loud. Our first question is for Dr. Berger. Why do you think the themes of nature law and the sacred run through our whole tradition?
Yeah, it's a big question. I just try to get it really small. It's often been said that philosophy begins with the question of whether the things that we all accept by convention, whether any of it is actually true by nature. Like every society has its own ideas of what's just and noble. These are the conventions. In Plato's great image, that's the cave that every society lives in. And philosophy is asking whether any of those conventions are by nature. So that tension, which is really, I think, the tool of philosophic inquiry, runs through, I think, all great thinkers. And then it's compounded or made complex by the biblical tradition or revealed religion. If there's a creator God, if God has determined reality, is there any nature, any fixed nature? And how does the sacred fit into that dichotomy between nature and convention? And finally, the issue that I've really kind of wrestled with and fought with other scholars about is whether the Bible and religion can have this distinction of nature and convention. Can the Bible have an idea of nature, the reality and nature of things? So they're big questions that doesn't surprise, it will kind of surprise me to see the concrete ways in which it showed up in all these other thinkers, you know, from medieval to modern. But when you think about it, these are such fundamental questions that I think last through human thought.
Mm-hmm. Great. All right, and next question is for Dr. Ozcan. The question is, it's from Lisa Hooper. So she says, it's so great to see you again, by the way. She says she has a very good friend doing his PhD work on an American variation of what you have done. It's such intellectually and emotionally challenging work, seeing the parallels and knowing plenty of others are looking at this modern American moment. I'm wondering what techniques you could pass on to other researchers for separating and protecting yourself from your own research.
Thank you, Lisa. I can't see you, but thank you very much for the question, which is a great question. These are very similar topics. I mean, when I worked on this book, I kept thinking about women supporting Trump. So, and also the last 4 years, like a lot of things prompted the reaction. Like, I mean, I saw this before. And so very similar processes are taking place in two different countries. And there are no techniques that I can think of. And I suspect there is none. I mean, these are topics that make you nervous. And I think they keep you nervous. Even after you are done with the book and everything, you don't know where it will land in. And So yeah, I mean, that's, I wish I could say something, I could promote something, but I'm afraid these are topics that we have to live with. And I wrote this book and now I have to deal with anything that it brings to me, right? Positive and negative. And the next question I see is also about Erdogan. So Erdogan regime is kind of, even Erdogan before came to power, he has been and his party has been very critical of the regime promoted by Atatürk. So Atatürk's regime was based on a model of Westernization. And so Erdogan came to power by constantly criticizing these different aspects of this project. So, I mean, it is not so easy because Atatürk's project, have been embraced by millions, but there are also social groups who fell outside of it. So he basically played those dynamics, but it is, you know, he is, his regime hasn't been very fond of the project brought by Atatürk in the first place.
Thank you. It looks like we've got one more question in the chat. This might be our final question. It is a very important question. It is from Eric Weedig and it's for Dr. Maveety. It is, were many of the Supreme Court justices bourbon drinkers?
The answer, Eric, is yes. Bourbon drinkers, absolutely. And bourbon, you know, is popular throughout American history, right? From the beginning of the domestic production of whiskey, when it's produced in Kentucky and gets its name, all the way up through the 20th century, and even now in, you know, the current revival of cocktail culture, et cetera. Probably one of the most, you know, outstanding bourbon drinkers of the Chief Justices was probably Fred Vinson, who was a very good friend of Harry Truman. That's kind of how he got nominated. And Harry Truman was known as a bourbon drinker, loved bourbon. Washington nowadays, just so you won't worry, is not as hard drinking a town as it once was. People are much more moderate. I don't know, is that a good thing or not? Who can say? But the stories you read about of mid-century, last century, that sort of culture of alcohol and politics has been succeeded by very different behaviors.
Did Ruth Bader Ginsburg drink cocktails?
Oh. Yeah, she did. And she had a favorite spirit, which was Campari, which is an Amaro. And of course, Campari figures in various cocktails, including my favorite cocktail, which is the Negroni.
Those are tasty.
I'll go have one right now. Celebrate our successful panel here.
If you were in New Jersey, I'd say I'd be right there. No.
This was a lot of fun.
Yeah, and thank you so much. We have 1 minute left. I want to be respectful of everybody's time. So I do want to take a moment to thank everybody who participated, whether you are a panelist or an attendee. I do want to thank Courtney Kearney and Amanda Morlas and Alan Velasquez, who were integral to putting this together, whether it was editing or communicating with you all or reaching out, all of it that took to make this go. And of course, all of our faculty authors who, without y'all, this obviously wouldn't be happening. And this was extremely fun and very lively. So thank you for participating, especially through all of your Zoom fatigue, which I know we're all experiencing. And then a reminder, we'll be doing this again tomorrow with a whole new batch of folks. So if you want to pop in tomorrow, we welcome you all back to hang out and do it all again.
I wanted to add one thing. You know, all of us and all the faculty, you go to your conventions in your field and so forth. You're a famous person. They know you all around the world. And in our own university, we don't really know enough, you know, about one another. And it's just any opportunity like this to, you know, branch out and hear what other people are working on. This is a pleasure.
Absolutely. And that's one of our favorite things about this is, you know, getting everybody across campus together, because those opportunities don't often exist. So it's always really fun. And there's a lot of commonalities between the struggles that y'all face, you know, putting this stuff together. So it's interesting to hear the different experiences, but also the connecting threads that throughout all of this. So again, thank you so much for participating, and enjoy the rest of your days. Hopefully it contains a Negroni or two.
Well, thank you all for organizing this. This is really nice.
Thank you. Thank you.
I've done a lot.
Yes. Thank you, y'all. I've laughed a lot. It's been wonderful. Yeah. I've learned a lot too, but it's just been, yeah, it's been great.
And just so you know,
thank you all.
There is a long faculty meeting about to start.
Sorry.
Negronis after that.
Right.
Bye, everyone.
Bye. Thank you.